Hi, and welcome to Artcasters 81. I'm Joshua Kimball, and here with me is a badass from Arizona.
How's it going, everyone?
Named Scott Circling. And then Kevin couldn't make it today. He's super busy, so we're flying solo yet again. And we also did it on Thursdays because, like, Thursday this week, because it just worked better for all of us. So
how are we flying solo if there's two of us?
I guess we're like the two of us combined could be cool, like Han Solo, right?
I don't know. We're like a two-line Voltron.
Exactly, with our powers, my iPhone in the head.
I guess I'm the torso. We just got feet or legs or hands floating around.
So yeah, we were going to talk about like support bases and stuff. And I think what got me thinking about it recently is that we do this monthly meetup, like once a month at Cantor's Deli in Los Angeles called Clam. And Jim Lujan, the guy, like one of the guys who started it, always wants to make sure we really remind people that it's M as in monkey, not N. That's not what you know for day. But we just kind of meet up, and it's like a way for all of us, like it's a bunch of independent creators, and we just kind of hold each other accountable to like creating our own projects, and then kind of try to figure out how we can support each other and help each other like network and stuff like that. So it's really collaborative and cool. But it was like super inspiring, and on my drive home, I was like, that should be our topic on Artcasters. Cause like, I was thinking about just like a lot of artists out there who may not have that kind of base, or like, you know, when I was starting in art, like how I built that base and stuff like that, and how I'm really thankful to have it. And so I just thought that would be kind of an interesting topic. So I don't know. I mean, the first thing I was thinking is like, maybe Scott, you can kind of kick us off on it or something. But the first thing I was thinking was like, how did you, like when you were first in art, did you have like a strong support base, you know?
Okay. Let me get back to that. I kind of want to get a little better understanding of what Clam is. So do you guys go there and create and draw, or is it more the networking thing, or is it both, or?
You know, it's funny because you can bring a sketchbook and stuff, but what I like about it, oddly enough, is that we don't draw.
that's cool. That's different than what I thought it was.
Yeah. It's like, I thought initially, like my first time going there, I thought it was going to be like a, you know, like a drink and draw kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And it kind of has that atmosphere, but nobody's pretending to really draw. Like they're just kind of there to talk about each other's work and just kind of shoot the shit and, you know, maybe like sharing cartoonist woes together.
Yeah.
But it's really interesting because it's like, I think I actually like that about it. I know it's weird, but I'm drawing so much like at work and on my own personal projects that it's actually nice to hang out with artists who can talk shop and stuff, but like, you're not like really feeling like you have to be drawing, you know? And I love drawing. Like I brought a sketchbook there before and just sketched people because there's some really weird, crazy characters there who just show up at Cantor's. A lot of like strange kind of old people. And like, to me, that's like one of the funnest things to sketch, you know? Cause they just have interesting posture or like weird wrinkles and stuff, you know? Mm-hmm. But in general, yeah, like I don't even bring a sketchbook anymore because I'm just like, I really enjoy just kind of hearing what everybody's doing and kind of like sharing what I'm doing and like, I don't know, just kind of being in a group of people that are equally excited about each other's work. It's cool. I don't know.
Yeah. You know? So is it mostly like artists, designers, illustrators, just creative people in general?
So we have indie animators, we have children's book artists, we have, you know, people who are working on illustrated books, we have people who are almost the majority are cartoonists, like working on indie comics.
Okay.
Some of them do like CG animation, and like it ranges all the way to like, like one of the newer guys, like he's not new, he's like he came like a little bit after I did. Earns does like documentary films and stuff, and one of them runs like a film festival and produces films and stuff. So it's like it's kind of across the board. The one uniting thing is just like that we're working on creative projects that are independent, like not really, we're aiming to have our own creator owned stuff as opposed to like, you know, trying to get on board, like get a gig drawing SpongeBob or something, right. You know? So
is that by happenstance or is that by design that's what people are?
Yeah. I mean, I think it's by design because the original dudes who set it up really like, I think established it to like the idea of it was that they were all working on independent projects. One of them was working on like an independent animation. I think Jim had just started working with Bill Plimpton on like this crazy project, like Revengeance, which you guys should check out. It's awesome. Yeah. But so he was feeling like pretty overwhelmed and just kind of like stressed and needed people to talk to about it. And I think all of the creators in it are kind of in a similar boat where they're like kind of like need a network of support. So it's as corny as it is, it's kind of like a support group for artists, which I think is actually kind of good. I don't know. I mean, does that make sense? I don't know.
Yeah. It's different kind of what I thought, but it's actually not too far. And I will get back to, you know, your original question, but it's not that different than something that me and I think it began with like a couple people, two or three people, but we started this meetup called West Side Creatives because I may have mentioned this before, but I'll go into it again. So I live on the west side of not technically in Phoenix, but it's all anything in the surrounding area of Phoenix is kind of considered Phoenix. So, but a lot of the, you know, the creative, you know, studios and ad agencies and a lot of that stuff is either in Central Phoenix or on the east side, and there wasn't really a whole lot for people on the west side. So we kind of started, you know, I had a friend who was a freelance graphic designer. At one time he was kind of, him and a partner were had a small design studio, and then they kind of split. But anyway, so we kind of started this West Side Creatives just for people on the west side, because there wasn't really anything out there. And it went for a good 2 years. And every once in a while, we'll still get together. It's not like a thing anymore, but like the core people that always went, there's probably five of us left that from time to time, we'll still meet together. But it was kind of that same thing. But it was, I guess, a little wider spread as far as who was involved. Like, it was basically if you're anyone in the creative business. So there would be people that are in, like, you know, some people were in marketing, some people were, you know, graphic designers, illustrators, filmmakers, all that kind of stuff. So, but yeah, we didn't draw or anything when we went there. Now that I think of it, it was just kind of, a lot of it was, you know, you go there to kind of air your grievances with the industry and just have a kind of shoulder to cry on or somebody to bitch and moan to or whatever, or talk shop to. It's kind of that type of thing. And it was definitely therapeutic. So yeah, it was, but yeah, I'm wondering, you know, there's some other things that we'll get into that I'm currently doing, but that's something I wouldn't mind to do more of every now and then. But it's good to, you know, it's good to have that kind of stuff because, whether you're just trying to get, you know, a career in art going, or you have a career in art and you're sitting here and you're either, you go off to your 9-to-5 or you're at home working, you know, all by yourself, you kind of need that camaraderie.
Yeah.
So.
Well, and like, I mean, you know, often like the people who get geeked out about your work aren't going to be like, you know, people who see you every day. Like, you know, if you think about it, like I have some friends who are fairly successful at stuff, but whenever I hang out with them, I'm proud of their successes and stuff, but I, you know, treat them like, hey, you're my buddy, you know, like,
yeah.
I don't treat them with like the reverie or interest or whatever that, you know, so I think that it's also important to meet up with people that are outside of your like instant near circle so that you can kind of see like if people are geeked out about your work and you want to like, I think it's important to find the right group too. Like one of the reasons I keep going to this thing is I've gone to other artist meetups and sometimes it kind of ends up being like a, trying to think of a way to put this politely, but sometimes it'll be like just like a measuring contest of sorts.
Okay.
You know, where it's just like, yeah, well, I did this. Oh, I worked for this client, you know, and it's kind of one-upsmanship.
Mm-hmm.
With like drawing and being like, oh yeah, well, I can draw better, like, you know. And some of that's healthy because it's like healthy competition and stuff. Like, you know, I mean, I still occasionally have moments where like if I see a friend just knock it out of the park with artwork, or even at my job, you know, if one of my designers like really does well on something, I like wanna up my game, you know.
Yeah.
So there's a healthy part of that, but there's also a part that's like so self-serving and kind of annoying about that. So it's nice to go to a place where, you know, it's like by design, we're kind of all showing interest in each other's stuff. And like, we make sure that, you know, we are actually legitimately interested in everyone's stuff who's there. So like, they're all really good. That doesn't hurt, you know? So like all their projects are really cool and interesting and they're passionate about them. So that makes it easier too, you know, like to show interest because you're not faking interest. You're like truly hoping these people succeed, you know? And I think there's something similar going on YouTube. So that kind of like sparked the topic, you know, because I'm starting to notice that, you know, with the very small subscriber base I have, but like it's a small subscriber base, but I've made like a couple really cool, I wouldn't call them like friends yet, but I call them like really, like close acquaintances, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but like we're starting to build friendships and support bases and stuff and do shout outs to each other and stuff. And it's, I don't think it's like forced shout outs. I think it's because we're like actually really wanting to watch each other's videos and wanting to see like, hey, what are you going to draw the next week? You know, I think that's cool. I don't know. But I don't feel like I've always had that as an artist. You know, that's why I was like, I think it might be a good topic, especially if you're a newer or younger artist, or, you know, an older artist and you're looking for that like support network. I'm imagining a lot of people in our chat, like I think our chat is a little community as well, you know, so.
Yeah, the chat's actually going pretty good. I've been kind of glancing over to it, but yeah, and I'll have to look a little closer. I don't know. I guess I can kind of go back to your original question as far as support system. I don't know how far you want to go back because, just kind of growing up in general, I was lucky to have pretty supportive parents.
Yeah.
Not everyone has that. I mean, for the most part. I mean, I guess my mom more than my dad. My dad's kind of like my mom and my dad are like total opposites. You know, I don't have any idea how they were married as long as they were. but my dad's just, he doesn't understand a lot of the, you know, he's just not a creative person. My mom was a little more of a, she didn't do it as professionally, but she always did like crafts and things, and she's all very, very creative as far as just anything that she does. She's like, you know, she wants everything to look nice and set everything up like that. My dad's kind of more matter of fact and everything, but they were both encouraging and stuff, you know.
Yeah.
My dad's kind of like, he still doesn't quite get what I do. I mean, it's, you know, like when I was working in game design, he just was baffled. He just had no earthly idea how the company made money off of, like, you know, because like it was, you know, it was, we did like Facebook games and stuff. So it was kind of that freemium model, and he just could not wrap his, he still to this day, he can't wrap his head around it or
you just draw all day and give stuff away for free and they pay you.
Yeah. Well, not necessarily that they pay me. He can understand, but he doesn't understand where that money came from to pay me. Like,
yeah, who plays video games?
Yeah. So, you know, yeah. Stuff like that. And, you know, so he was kind of that type of guy. So,
yeah.
You know, anytime, and of course, being in this business, anytime where, you know, I get laid off or something, which happens a lot. I mean, he's like, oh no, not again. And this and that. And of course he's kind of been at this job where it's pretty stable. He's been doing it for, you know, forever, and he's like an expert at what he does and everything. So he's probably got, I would say, pretty good job security. Of course, at his age, he wants to retire, but they don't want to let him because he's the only one that really knows how to do what he does. But, you know, he's been in that world where, you know, he'll retire and get a gold watch and all that stuff. But that's like, that's a dying thing that doesn't really exist anymore. And because he's never known anything different, that's all he kind of knows. So,
yeah.
And I love my dad. He's just, you know, and there has been times where he's helped me out. You know, if I did lose my job and stuff, he's, you know, he's helped me out and stuff. So he's definitely supportive in that way and everything. But, you know, he doesn't quite get it. And I think, you know, hopefully I get to the point where I'm, you know, and even at my age, it's kind of, and I have been successful doing this in the fact that I've been able to make a living out of it for this long. Yeah. But now I'm kind of in this transition thing where I'm kind of, at least what I'm doing on the side isn't working for clients. It's trying to build my own thing and selling my own artwork on the side. So it's like kind of like starting over. So I'm hoping that'll happen before too long, you know, so he'll get to kind of see that and see that his son actually was able to kind of, not that I haven't already, like I said, but anyway, you know what I mean.
Yeah.
But anyway, but all in all, that, you know, my parents were really supportive, so I'm very grateful for that. And a lot of people, they don't have that, you know. I mean, and it's difficult. I guess it would be difficult. You can't, if you don't have that, I mean, that could definitely create some problems. And sometimes I think it's probably best to look elsewhere for that kind of support, because I don't think there's any way, if people don't get it, they're just not going to get it. And like, same thing with friends. I've got my art friends and I've got other friends, and the other friends, I don't bring it up because they can't wrap their head around it. It's just,
yeah.
You know, it's so foreign for somebody to understand kind of that, what, you know, what my goals are as far as trying to make a living being a creative and everything like that. And not having that quote stability that people, you know, falsely, I think, you know, it's kind of a myth, job security and all that stuff. And even though now I do have a job, but I'm not under the, I mean, I've been laid off so many times that I know, I you know, now if it happens tomorrow, I'll be like, okay, you know, first few times it was like, oh boy, what am I going to do? And I was like, oh, yeah. Okay, well, I'll figure something out.
Yeah, I think I'd be pretty weirded out if I got laid off. But at the same time, like, it's funny because, like, the area I live in, like, the majority of people who live out in the Antelope Valley, like, work for, like, Northrop Grumman or Lockheed Martin, mm-hmm. or, like, NASA or Edwards Air Force Base. Like, that's a huge employer out here, you know? And all of the, like, so I've known, like, engineers, like a lot of my friends' parents were like engineers, you know, and like engineering is supposed to be this, well, I mean, when I was younger, it was like supposed to be this like kind of secure field, you know, like you learn engineering and it takes a really smart person to do, like really like science smart, you know, but at the same time, like they get laid off like every 4 or 5 months. Like, I mean, I don't know what it's like now, but I mean, the few people I know who are like in engineering, they get laid off all the time and they have to like move to Texas to like a different plant or something like that. I think that happens in like careers all the time, you know? So I think you're right about it. Just kind of like some of it's like an illusion, you know? I mean, there is like some jobs that are more secure, you know, but I think you're right about that. Like, I think it is kind of a semblance of like stability, because who knows what, you know, what's going to happen tomorrow, like whatever business you're in or whatever you learn, you know, like you're in the stock market with billions of dollars and then the housing market crashes and you're poor, you know, like it's just like, I don't know. But, what's funny is like my experience, like my dad, totally got it. And I think because he got it, he was a little bummed that I had talent in art or that I showed interest in art. But he wasn't like discouraging. He just like knew, he knew the field, because he had run his own design business and like been pretty successful in like the 70s, like doing like paste up stuff, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And, So for him, I think it was more just like, I wish you could have shown an interest in like accounting, you know, like.
Well, I can.
How hard it is, you know. Like,
yeah, but, and I can definitely, I can sympathize because, you know, with my boys at least, I mean, they want to go into game design and having been in that, and they don't want to go into it, I don't think so much as an artist, but more like coming up the concepts of the games or the gameplay and things like that, at least my oldest son.
Yeah.
And again, I'm kind of the same way just because I just know how hard it is. And to be honest, I mean, and this is the one thing, you know, unfortunately this is the truth and it's the hard truth, but just being an artist isn't really, or even a good artist isn't enough. I mean, you've got to, I mean, what I would advise anyone to do if they want to become an artist, take marketing classes, learn how to market your work, learn how to sell your work. That's, and you know, of course that takes away from your creativity, you know, but that's the hard truth. I mean, you just, you need to know that stuff. And I don't think that he's at that point yet. I mean, you've got to, well, you know.
That just makes me think of like, there's a reason that people like who go to like Art Center get work out of Art Center. And it's not so much, I mean, Art Center has excellent teachers and, you know, the artists come out really good. But the key thing that Art Center has kind of built into their system, and I'm not like an alumni from there or whatever, but it's like that network that is built with all of the students. So it's like if you go there, which I could never afford, but you know some people do. If you were to go there and just be a dick, you know, and then like graduate and be the best artist ever, you would have completely wasted all that money on that school, you know, because like the and that goes for any school, not just Art Center. Art Center is just a good example because it's like they have such a like tight knit kind of, at least in the LA area, it's known like that they're just kind of like they have a really high closure rate, like. Or whatever it is for transferring to jobs after college, you know?
Oh yeah, I definitely know their reputation. So, and like, yeah. Like when I went to community college, but my, at least the sort of the curriculum, I know my instructor sort of borrowed things from that. Now that network wasn't necessarily there, but just kind of goes to show you how, you know, kind of well respected they are and everything.
Oh yeah, and it's funny because like I didn't go there, but because I knew how networked they all are, because like they really do kind of encourage students to like really collaborate and really keep in contact like outside of school. And that's something that, I mean, I'm still pretty tight with like the alumni that graduated when I did from school, you know, and that is a good network. But I don't think I quite grasped that as much as I should have when I was like fresh out of school. That doesn't mean you like kiss ass. It just means you develop friendships and relationships, like genuine friendships and relationships with other artists. Because, you know, chances are, like, you know, for one thing, you're gonna work on your own stuff and drive yourself crazy. So you have to have those people to talk to, you know. And then the second thing is just like, you know, like the reality is, there is a huge who you know factor to like getting work, you know, because and that goes for anyone. Like I'll hire someone I know over someone I don't, not out of preference, just because I'm like, I'll know, are they good artists, are they good with people, are they gonna like piss off my staff, you know, like, you know, are they gonna catch on and be professional like in the work environment, like that, like that's so much easier when you know someone, because you're like, okay, I totally know this person will function well, you know. So of course you're going to hire people you like to work with and like people you like to be around. And it doesn't hurt to like know people, you know, but I want to always hedge that, cause I feel like people could kind of become too like, I don't know. Where am I heading, Scott?
I'm too much into the marketing thing unless, I don't know.
Not the marketing, just kind of like too, Hollywood about it, like,
oh, okay.
So there's like a negative side to that too, which is like if you're really networked but you're really artificial, like eventually that kind of shows too, you know. So it's like that's why I say like genuine relationships, because it's like, you know, I don't know. It's kind of an unspoken thing, but it's like you can kind of tell when people are like me, and they're not really interested in you. They're just kind of interested in like, where's your client list? You know, that kind of people.
Mm-hmm.
That's not necessarily the best strategy either. Although I can relate to people who would do that, especially fresh out of school or like if you're hungry for work, it's like you're hungry for work, you'll take it anywhere. But I think really building those like actual friendships like is super important, you know? And it'll help you out when you're in a bind, like, because even if you're in a bind and like they can't help you out with work, at least like 80% of artists, or probably more than that, are going to relate to being out of work, you know, because they've all been there if they're not there now, you know? So I don't know. I'm kind of rambling, but I think it's good to build those friendships and those relationships. And like, you know, like, it's funny because like, for me, a lot of the people I knew in high school, I like never talked to. And I don't mean that in a negative way. It's just we all kind of grew apart and stuff like that. But the friendships that I built in college, and like, it doesn't have to be college. I'm just thinking like, once you get into kind of the professional arena, like once you start introducing yourself into the art world or into an industry, those connections you make last a really long time, especially like early jobs too. Like a lot of the people who like first kind of mentored me and stuff, like when I got into an actual creative position, like a lot of those people I still talk to and still email and still keep in contact with. And it, you know, a lot of them would be the first people I'd hire if they were out of work, you know? So it's like, I don't know. I don't know where I'm heading with that.
Yeah. No, I mean, and it, because it's like when I worked, the first game studio I worked at, you know, we, you know, it was like a family and you get to know people and everything. And I still, you know, at least through Facebook, sometimes we'll get together with some of those people. Some people have moved out of state or out of the country or, you know, or whatever. But, you know, we're still, you know, we still see what everyone's doing online, and if something comes up, sometimes people will recommend positions or something like that. And then basically when that first studio that I was at kind of basically scaled down to the point where I think maybe they had one or two artists left on staff. And then another game studio opened, and four of us who were at the other studio ended up getting a job at this other one. And part of it was networking. It's like, well, you know, in interviewing, it's like, well, yeah, we were looking to hire, you know, a number of artists. Who else do you know and everything? And of course, we mentioned our friends and stuff. So, yeah. So
and that you probably didn't mention were people you knew who were dicks.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, I was lucky enough to not know too many dicks working at the game studio where I was at.
That's the thing. That's the thing. You're not going to really meet a lot of people who are like that, who get in the creative field, because it's just like if you're working with a team, you really have to work with a team, and like as cliche as it is, you kind of have to be a team player. Either that, or you have to be like the next, like, you know, M.C. Escher or Albert Durer or something. You know, if you're like a genius, then like maybe they'll keep you on. But I mean, the likelihood is they'll probably go for somebody who's like not a genius, but like likable, you know, because it doesn't make their day suck, you know. But like, so I don't know. To me, it's like it's cool to like I've been kind of out of doing creative kind of meetups and stuff. I think it's because I haven't really conventioned in a while, because I've set this ridiculous goal of like not going to comic conventions to list things out. And I think because of that kind of void, it's just like really nice to have this like meetup that's like once a month that, and then also YouTube, like, you know, to have the art casters and just, you know, people who comment on our channels and stuff, like that kind of thing, I think really does keep me, perpetuating forward. Cause I feel like otherwise I'd probably feel like a tree falling in the forest, you know, with no one around. And that's just not necessarily, man, I don't know, but I wonder if I would still do it, you know? without a support base. I don't know if that makes sense.
The comic or the personal work?
Yeah, like I mean, I might, but I, you know, it's hard to know. It's like yeah. I've been at points, you know, it ebbs and flows because it's like, you know, I think when I was younger, I did have a few points where I was like the only person I knew working on comics, the only new person I knew working on personal stuff, and it was like super like depressing, you know. So like stuff like that, or like drink and draws are a good way to just kind of reach out, stuff like that. I don't know. I think it's important, you know?
Yeah, that's the one thing that I recently started doing, and I'm looking to start going more often, but that one drink and draw, life draw thing that I go to.
Yeah.
And like I said, I have to talk to, my other friend that I brought there, because he's the one that wanted to start something else. And after, you know, we went there, we started talking to some other artists there and mentioning, you know, kind of this idea of doing some other kind of drink and draw that's maybe not a little less structured or whatever, where you could draw whatever you want, not just the model.
Yeah.
But yeah, I'm looking forward to kind of going back and doing that, and hopefully, you know, try to do it like they do it every month, but do more of that stuff, because, you know, I do kind of miss that.
Yeah.
But and just like you said, there's, you know, with whatever YouTube or like the conventions, if you are somebody who does those convention circuits, I mean, that's another whole support system. I mean, people there, you know, but it's out there. And if, like I said, if you don't have that kind of support of your family and friends, you can find it, even if you're, you know, it's easier, I guess, if you're in a big city or something like that, but it's available online. It's, you know, even maybe you've had to travel a little bit, I'm sure you could figure out ways to start, you know, something through like a meetup or, you know, something online, where that's even Craigslist or something. I don't know. That might be a little sketchy, but there's ways you can do it. Sometimes it's kind of, you have to make that effort to make it happen, and that's kind of the scariest thing, the thing where people sometimes don't pull the trigger. But you know, sometimes you kind of get over that, just like with art, because there's so much kind of standing in your way. Sometimes you have to, you know, you have to kind of make things happen for yourself.
Yeah, for sure. And I think like another thing to keep in mind with that too is like, you know, finding the right support group, because like by support, I mean like, or support system or whatever you want to call it.
Yeah.
But it's like, I mean, there is a huge part of that that is support. And it's like one of the easiest ways to guard or support from people is to support other people. You know, so like, you know, like, I think if you find a good group of people who aren't, like, super negative, because, like, I've also been to, like, artist things that are, like, hangouts or groups that kind of meet up, and it ends up being, like, a meetup where they all kind of, like, praise the four people who have a published book, or, you know, like, or it becomes just kind of, like I was saying before, like, a measuring contest where it's just, like, you're not really there to support, you're more just there to show off and get an ego boost and leave. And like, there's a difference, I think, between that and just getting like genuine support, which is just like, you know, people who are like actually sincerely interested in what you're doing, you know, and like, and also like you're sincerely interested in what they're doing. So like, it doesn't have to be other artists, it could be like composers, it could be like people writing books. Especially if you're a cartoonist and you're doing what we do, which is like, you know, writing your own stuff, like writers are sometimes more supportive than a lot of comic people, you know, there's a lot of comic people who just want to work for the big two or big three or whatever, you know, and that's their goal and that's their end goal, and they don't want to write their own stuff. And sometimes I'll have less in common with that than somebody who like wants to write fan fiction. Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, so maybe, you know, if you're in that smaller area, you find somebody who just has a dream project and they're working on a book, or they're working on, you know, I don't know, like hell, sculpting stuff in their backyard, whatever it is, you know. I think people who are making stuff that's like their own self-driven stuff kind of have a commonality, and like also are drawn to each other a little bit. I think that's what's happening on YouTube, honestly, you know, but I don't know. I mean, just kind of, it's weird to think like what, like without support like that, like where I would be in my own career, you know, like both personally and professionally, you know, so it's hard to think like what that would lead to, you know, I don't know. Anyway, just rambling.
Yeah, and it's I know, you know, a lot of us artists, myself included, are introverts, and just the fact that, you know, being on YouTube and everything, that was like a struggle for me, and now, you know, now I've got, you know, almost over 500 videos out there, and you get better. It takes a while, but I mean, with anything, the thing that I would say about the art thing, and you really have to be honest with yourself, and you have to say, you know, how passionate are you about this, you know, for, you know, to be an artist or to try to pursue this as either, you know, just, you know, it's like a lifestyle, you know, basically. But you've got to be realistic with yourself, and, you know, do you have that drive to, because, I mean, very few people can do this without just basically pouring everything into it, you know. It's just, it's not that easy, you know, and so do you, you know, if you're, it's like, for instance, if you want to start a YouTube channel, I mean, you kind of got to be persistent. You kind of keep doing it, because with very few exceptions, it takes a while to build that audience, and I'm still trying to build mine, but there's definitely been progress made, and, you know, some people can grow theirs faster, some people it takes longer. There's no like set way, or there's, you know, you can't really compare yourself to other people, because everyone has a different journey, and yours, you know, yours may take a little longer. You may, you know, hit some crazy viral thing and blow up. You don't know, but you know, you really can't give up. I mean, it's that way with YouTube. It's probably going to be this way with this new thing that I'm doing right now, as far as trying to sell these digital products and things like that. You know, if I just throw up one of these products, probably nothing's going to happen. And I was just telling Josh before we started, on the last show, I was talking about how I didn't sell very many prints. And that's one of the reasons why I'm starting to do this stuff instead of prints, because I've got a decent amount of prints. But then all of a sudden, within a week, I'm like selling prints. And I don't know why, I don't know what changed, but I'm averaging like a print a day now. And for me, you know, some people that's not a big deal, but for me, that's pretty cool. So, you know, you gotta kind of, and once you hit sort of that momentum, then you kind of double down on some of that stuff. So now I need to go back and start promoting some of this stuff. And the weird thing is, it's like with anything else, it's like, you know, something about like the celebrity with the coffee, like celebrities will go in a coffee shop and people, and they'll, oh, it's on me. I'll buy your coffee. But now they're at that point where they don't need it. Whereas before, when they're struggling actors, it's like, that's when they needed the free coffee, you know? So, yeah. But, you know, so it's like this weird thing, but when you start to sell stuff on an Etsy or whatever, and you get that momentum, that's when the network or Etsy or whatever, they start sharing that stuff, because, oh, there's something's happened with this person here, and he's got something going. So, you know, we're going to help boost that, because if you make money, then they make money. So, but you never know when that's going to happen. Or like right now, I said, this could just be a fluke thing. Maybe it'll keep going, you know, maybe I'll start making more sales, but yeah, you never know when things are going to, you know, when things are going to take off. So you got to stick with it. And it's going to be, you're going to reach these points where like, is all this for nothing? And then, of course, going back to that support system, it's hard to justify that to somebody who's not a creative, who hasn't been trying to do this stuff, you know, hey, nothing's happening for you. What, you know, why are you wasting your time with this? And, you know, if you're not like us, if you're a muggle, you're just not going to understand, you know. So you got to find people that do understand, and that's kind of what we're talking about today.
Yeah, if you throw in the towel before even starting the fight, like, what kind of advice are you going to give a fighter? You know, it's like, it's just like you want to, keeping with the fight analogy, you want to be dealing with people who've been like who are in fist fights every day. Not that to me that's polar opposite for me, because I even the thought of hitting people freaks me out. I'm like the least violent person, but at the same time, it's a bit of a battle making art, and it's like you want to be with people who are able to share their traumatic experiences and their successes, you know. So like people who you can talk about your PTSD from the industry and people who, you know, you can't, you know, like it's just kind of, it's like you need, you know, you need your comrades in arms, you know.
Yeah.
So I'm glad to like kind of see that building on YouTube, and I'm glad to be kind of rebuilding that base in California, you know, because I lived in Portland for a while. So it took a while when you move to a new state. It's like you kind of have to rebuild that. And then I kind of had to rebuild it again, you know, coming back here. So it's kind of neat to see it kind of building again, you know. Yeah.
Yeah, I just saw my walk by and I was thinking to myself, that's another thing with like your significant others, like you guys are both artists, right?
Yep.
So there you have sort of that support system too. I mean, I'm sure the dynamics of what you guys work on and stuff is probably a little bit different, but a lot of people have that problem with their significant others where they don't understand, and that can create huge problems because, for instance, if you're, you know, sharing, you know, an income, or if you're, you know, that, and that's a really difficult one, you know, and I had that when I was married. Now, not so much now, because like my girlfriend and I, she's not an artist or, you know, by any stretch of the imagination or anything like that, you know.
Yeah.
We're different in that way, but you know, our money is all separate, you know, everything's separate, and she's super supportive, you know, and
yeah.
So but yeah, that can definitely create problems, and that's a difficult one, because I think with your parents it's a little different, you know, because if you're a grown person it's kind of like, well, this is sort of my life, but if you're in a relationship with somebody, that could create problems. So hopefully, you know, that could be a whole other show, which, you know,
Okay. It's
really, sometimes you're just, it, you know, there's not much of an answer to that.
That's a good thing to bring up, because I mean, like, you know, the thing is, when you marry somebody, at least in my opinion, it's like, you're going to be each other's biggest support base, you know? And so like, I'm always constantly thankful that I married somebody who gets it and does illustration and can draw honestly better than I can, because like, you know, there's weird quirky things, like, you know, a lot of weird quirky things where it's just like, yeah, I'm gonna stay up for 4 hours after the kids asleep to work on my comic, you know. That's not kind of like your normal thing. I mean, I think maybe there's some dudes who like get off work and like have a beer and watch TV for 4 hours, maybe. But it's a little different to be like, I'm going to just like kind of obsess over this thing every single night. And so like somebody who is creative, does make stuff, like has made kids books, has done the hard work, has had to pull the all-nighters, you know, to hit deadlines and stuff, especially when I was freelance, that was like immensely helpful, because to have somebody who had freelanced living with me, like when I was going through the horrors and the joys of freelance, that was really helpful, because they understood like how hard it is to get clients, how much hustle you have to do just to get your name out there. You know, and then like how many kind of sleepless nights you have to pull just to get, you know, paid and get deadlines hit and stuff. So yeah, that's like a huge thing. And once again, like if I didn't have that, cause most of my successes as an artist came after Maya and I were together. Like when we first started dating, like even the Zarek grant thing, like I had all this self doubt and stuff, and like she was like super encouraging to kind of get that out and send it out, and helpful in the process of like even making it and giving me feedback and stuff. So yeah, that's like huge. I mean, that's that's probably like one of the, that's probably the big support, you know, because that's what, luckily we take each other with each other to different states, so it's like that helps in those transition times too, where you're just like stuck without a support base, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it could be a situation where, I guess the one I was, when I was married, it kind of, it started out as, you know, support, being supportive. And then sometimes, and it kind of sounds like Kevin was in the same situation, so he's not really here, so I won't speak too much for him. But sometimes, you know, like I said, in some ways it's a lot to ask of somebody. So I don't want to say like, I don't want to say, well, you know, they don't know what it's like. And I mean, it is a lot to ask of somebody to kind of, you know, be around and wait for something that may not happen, you know, while you're pursuing these dreams and stuff. So it is a lot to ask of somebody, but you know, sometimes it starts off that way where they're supportive. And then after a while, if they're not wired like we're wired, it's just like, well, you've done this so many times, when is something going to happen? And, you know, I can't deal with this anymore. And, you know, what can you say? I mean, it's just, you know.
Yeah. And I think like that's, so like that also like, and I know you guys aren't this scenario, but it's like that's something I always keep in mind too, because while my wife understands creative and stuff, like there's still like you do have to be conscientious of the other person, you know? And so like there are dreams I will be pursuing, but there's also like a financial responsibility that I'll stick to just to make sure that like there's food on the table, you know, that kind of stuff. And so like, which I know, like I know you and Kevin, so I know you guys were there, you were responsible and stuff like that. But it's like, so I think that, you know, it's a two-way thing, and it's funny because it's in marriage, but that's also in hangouts and in friendships and stuff like that. It's a two-way thing. And so like if you're not giving support and then you're expecting support to be guarded, like that's not going to happen very quickly, you know, may never happen, you know. I'm thinking about like a marketing strategy I just heard recently where you could do the whole scattershot thing and you could just like and subscribe to like a million YouTube channels, and then once they've subscribed, you unsubscribe. I overheard somebody saying that as a recommendation for like building followers, and I was like, I don't think those are going to be long lasting followers.
Yeah, you don't want to buy a follower. You don't want. I mean, it's got to be. Yeah. It's got to be natural, or else it doesn't matter. I mean, unless all you want is to show that you've got subscribers.
Yeah.
And, but that's, I mean, and subscribers, it's, you know, subscribers and likes and all, a lot of people put a lot of importance on stuff like that. And I was telling you, Josh, it's like views is important. View time is even more important. How long somebody stays on your video and stuff. But like, you at like I mentioned this last week, you with 200 subscribers are getting about your videos, each video, if you pick any particular random video, is getting close to what I'm getting. So it doesn't, subscribers don't necessarily mean everything. Yeah. You may not have that as many subscribers, but the ones you have are obviously engaged, and that's the most important thing.
Yeah,
And if you're just trying to buy subscribers or doing sub for subs, those people aren't really going to be engaged. They just want bragging rights, saying, "Oh, I got so many subscribers."
Yeah, I mean, it might work, but it just seems like maybe it does work. I don't know, but like, it's not a route I'd want to take, you know? Because like once again, I've been to those meetups, and I'm using the meetups as like an analogy for the internet as well, because it's still people, you know, that we're dealing with here. But it's like, I've been to those like, you know, like artist parties where you go and it's like, just like people introduce you and they want to know what you can do for them. Like that's the only interest they have. And I'm sure we've all met people like that where you can just feel it. Like, it's hard to explain, but it's just like I said, when Kevin and I were doing the podcast, like I could tell when I was getting an email from a student who like, or somebody who was new to the industry, who like really wanted to know some stuff about illustration. And then some that like literally just wanted a client list. Like they wanted me to do the work for them. And it's a difference, you know, it's like, it's a difference in, and it's hard to explain how you can feel that, but I think it's like a compliment. You can usually feel if somebody's being fake with a compliment, you know?
Yeah.
And so like, best thing with that kind of thing, I think, with building those communities and stuff, is be genuine with compliments, you know, like subscribe to people you like and, you know, get into like communities of people you can root for, you know. That doesn't mean like you have to think they're all incredible or better than you are. It's just more of like you have to actually be invested in, you know. Otherwise, you're kind of wasting your time and they're wasting their time. You know what I mean? I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I think, I don't know. I think that's kind of, I mean, that's kind of what I got on that for like the investment thing. But, you know, I kind of wonder, like, because oddly enough, like cartooning is really isolated. So there's also, I'm sure, a counter to that where you could get too invested in communities and just never make the art. And I've met people who have that too. So it's like, I don't know, you know?
Yeah. It's a juggling act. I mean, it's like, and I'm dealing with that right now. I mean, basically, if you follow me on Instagram, I mean, you haven't seen much from me because, and it's not like it's that hard to post something on Instagram, but you know, just I'll kind of break down the fourth wall right now for everyone. Like, I'm doing some portions of my videos I'm doing ahead of time, so it's like I don't want to post something that you haven't seen on my YouTube channel before I air that. But then again, by the time I get there, I forget about it and stuff like that. So like all the other social, you know, networking stuff or, you know, media stuff is just kind of taking a back seat while I do this 100 days. And also, frankly, it's just like the time involved. I don't have that much to do all this other stuff. Like, you know, the stuff that I'm working right now, these little avatar things.
Yeah.
I'm just setting aside just the only time really, again, I'm working on them is right here at the Artcasters. But, you know, once I wrap up that 100 days, I'll be able to spend a little more time on some of this other stuff and get back to, you know, normal, I guess.
Yeah, it's cool. It's a fine balance, though, because, like I said, I love the YouTube community, but, like, you know, on that note, like, you know, you might have noticed, like, I haven't posted in, like, you know, well, I posted today for, like, the first time in, like, half a week, and a little over half a week, and I was, like, getting to a point where I was doing almost every day, and I had Easter weekend, and then I was like, you know what, I need a break. Not from comics, like I've stayed just hitting, like to me that's a non-negotiable, like I have to work on my comic every day. Maybe 2 or 3 days out of the year I don't, you know. But like YouTube, it's like, I was in one of those positions where it's like, for instance, like the meeting on Wednesday, it's like, do I do YouTube or do I go have human interaction with people in person, you know? And it's like, occasionally you really do have to like, kind of, once again, you just kind of, it's a juggling act where it's like, I think most of the people I know on YouTube have their own channels as well, and it's like, I think they relate to just needing a day or two off.
Oh, yeah. And you're like crushing it on YouTube anyway, as far as putting out vlogs every single day, so I mean, it's, if you didn't put out one a day, I'm not gonna worry too much. Where there's other people that, you know, that I really like that kind of just drop off, and then it's like, when are you gonna have another video? They like do the weekly videos and they skip a week, and then another week goes by, and then maybe they'll come out with a video. I'm like, oh cool, but then, you know, it's like, I don't know.
Yeah, I think I mean, you know, like, even when I started the vlog and stuff, I didn't know what I could commit to, but I was like, I'll try to commit to at least one a week. So I joke on my vlog, at the end of my vlog every time, even if I, like, post the next day, I'm like, I'll see you guys next week. Because I'm like, to me, that's like, I don't know if people catch on to that, if you're, like, watching my channel or subscribe to it, but for me, it's, like, more of a personal promise to the audience that I will at least within a week see you, you know?
Yeah.
And, like, because that's something I knew I could maintain, and I knew if you can't keep that consistent, like, whatever it is, if it's once every 2 weeks, whatever, if you can't kind of frequently be updating, like, it is kind of like, that's the juggle, right? Because it's like, you know, there's also a lot of artists who made it really huge and you know, there's probably artists now that are really huge and have like no social media presence, you know? So it's not the only way, but it does seem like in the industry now, it's like you really do have to constantly be at it. And then also with cartooning, you're like sitting isolated in front of a drawing board, you know? So it's that juggle, right? Like, how do you do that?
Yeah.
I don't know.
And I don't know too many people that really hit the ground running like you did. I mean, you basically started your channel and then it wasn't very long before you were like putting out almost a video a day. Most people don't jump into it like that. Most people, kind of, like myself included, kind of build up to that. You know, because I had done a few videos before I decided to jump into 100 Days of Making Comics. But I don't know. And sometimes that's kind of dangerous too, because like, some people don't know what they're in for. I've seen so many people just start the 100 days and not really think about it or figure, you know, kind of look forward to how am I going to make this happen? How am I going to get a video out every day? And they just start it, which in some ways that's okay, because some different people are fueled different ways. Like some people, that's how they have to do it. They just have to jump into it. Me, I I'm going to plan a little more to figure out how I'm going to make this happen and what the best way to get these videos out and everything are. So, you know,
I think I might be one of those people. Like like the way I finished my first comic was really kind of that, like I didn't really know what I was doing and I kept waiting to know what I was doing. And then finally I was like, well, I'm never going to know what I'm doing until I just do it. And then I'll figure it out. You know, like, and then the weird thing is that kind of happened. Like I did kind of start to figure it out. Oh, okay. Like I don't want to use Sharpies. Like that was my first thing, was like, I was like, I'm going to be the guy who uses Sharpies, you know? And then it's like, you use Sharpies and you're like, well, these suck. They dry up. Like when I'm not even finished with the panel, I still love Sharpies, but I'd never use them for my final art now. If you can, that's awesome. I think, Hellboy, oh my gosh, Mike Mignola, I think he used Sharpies on a lot of Hellboy.
Oh, really?
Kind of rad, yeah. So there's great artists who can do cool stuff with the Sharpie, but like for me, I was like, oh, that's why all the guys use this like dip ink, you know? And then I had to try that, and then I was like, this sucks to have to clean my brush every time. Okay, that's why people use breath pens. And like, oh, okay, I want to use Rapidographs because these cheap pens just don't get the line I want. And then it's like, well, these Rapidographs are impossible to clean, so I'll go to Microns, you know? It's like you always end up kind of edging. But like, I wouldn't have known, like, because I think I'm slightly rebellious too, I'd just be like, well, that's what you use. Like when I was younger, you know, I'd be like, well, that's what they use. I'll use cheap stuff and make it just as good, you know? And so like for me, I have to learn the hard way. Like I have to jump in and kind of start drowning and then I swim, you know? Like,
yeah.
I don't know if that makes sense.
Yeah, Abe Stapien in the chat says that's how he did his challenge. He just kind of like jumped into it. I didn't know anything and kept going and knowing something, haha. He's been putting out videos. So some people that works for, you know, it's just, I guess you have to know yourself.
I will say, like, the one thing I was shocked by when I started doing this, and I didn't quite do the 100 days, but I've kind of developed, like, I got into this in my last vlog, but I kind of developed a habit where it's like I'm kind of doing the 100 days, but my goal is to do it kind of 365. Like, that's kind of my 100 days, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So I'd say it'll be more like 355 days out of the year. Not for videos, just for comic work. But it would be fun to do 100 days, but I don't know if I could keep up with that. That's an insane amount of work. Like, so before you ever get into it, like if you're going to do video posts, especially like the editing, you know, like video editing takes a long time, and even like the simplest things. And what's surprising to me, what was the big curve, was just the amount of time it takes for things to upload and to transfer. Like just to transfer from whatever your device is to your computer, it can be just like the most time, like the hugest time suck. And then like the learning curve of that, you know, where you kind of export or import and it like fails. And then you're like, but that was like 4 hours, you know? So, but like, once again, like, I don't know, like, I think it helped me, like, when Kevin came here and, like, literally was just telling me, he was like, well, dude, like, because I was like, yeah, I'm kind of digging that, because he talked about YouTube and the community and kind of explained it a little more to me, because I'm old and I was just like, what's YouTube? You look up cat videos on that, right? And I didn't know there was, like, this whole, like, wealth of just awesomeness on here. But so he sold me on that, but I was like, well, when I get the right camera or when I blah blah blah. And
yeah.
And you know, it was kind of like the talk that I had before having a kid, which is just like, well, look, if you want a kid, just have a kid. You're never gonna have money to have a kid. It's really expensive. It's insane. You just never will, like, save up the right cushion to where it's perfect. It just won't happen. Same thing with, like, YouTube. It's just like, you know, you could have all the equipment in the world and the highest production levels and launch a YouTube channel and, like, get one subscriber, you know, like, so, yeah. Like, why wait? I don't know. But I think that is a personality thing, you know, because there's also a brilliance to, like, method and approach and pre-planning that can be really good. I think both can have negatives, you know, and positives.
Yeah. And, like, which you're back to kind of the subject and everything about support system. I mean, just and you, what you're talking about with what you were thinking about as far as YouTube and everything and being cat videos. Just imagine, like, I usually don't tell people I make YouTube videos just because it's like at my age, like, what are you doing making YouTube videos? And, you know, people don't understand that. So, you know, I just kind of keep that under wraps.
They think vlogging, they picture like a 14-year-old, like,
yeah,
my nails, that's amazing. With this, you know, like, or walking around with selfie sticks and stuff. That's like, I can understand the negative view, you know. I didn't really have a negative view of YouTube. I just didn't know that it was such a thing, you know. Because I did start a little earlier. Like, I made some process videos, like, years ago. But they were, like, they were for my blog, you know. Like, I didn't think of just doing them for them, you know. I did them as, like, something that I could post on my website. So it was interesting. Like, to me, that was the biggest eye-opener, was, like, oh, you can, like, this is its own thing, you know. Which is kind of rad, I think.
Yeah.
But yeah, it is hard to, like, I don't mention that I do vlogs at my work at all.
Yeah, they see me because on my lunch I've got my little camera arm thing and I'm working on my comic book and they come by because they do, you know, my boss does videos and stuff and he's on social media because he's the creative person and he's the one that, like, basically he's the face of the company. So he'll do, like, demos on how to do the cards and all this stuff like that. And so they're asking me about my camera arm, cause it's a nice one. It's like around $40. I actually bought one for my daughter for Christmas cause she wanted to do YouTube videos. And at the time I just had this kind of cheap one and I liked hers. So I went and bought one myself, but, you know, they're looking at it and, like, I think now they want to get one. So, like, you know, and, you know, $40 is a good chunk of change to spend on equipment like this. But of course, you know, my boss and they've got a whole, you know, we've got a whole videographer and an assistant to the videographer and all this super heavy duty camera equipment. And I'm like, really, this is what you want to do? So, I mean, you want to use this for, and so, yeah, you know, for, like, video, YouTube videos and stuff, he just uses his phone and stuff like that. So, I don't know. Kind of a segue. But, yeah, but I don't, you know, people are wondering, you know, kind of what I'm doing, and I don't usually explain it. It is like, oh, this is my personal thing. This is my comic book. And they're like, oh, that looks cool. But beyond that, you know.
Have you ever just tried the explanation? Like, I'm just completely insane. Like, I just film myself doing everything just for me. So,
yeah, well, that's like, yeah, and that's kind of what, just trying to put in these little vloggy bits inside my 100 days video, like, people are, oh, he's got his camera out again, you know. So not at work, but just like my family and stuff. And my girlfriend's like, I'll be happy when this thing's over, because I'm always pulling out my camera filming stuff.
I don't, it is funny though, because I think a lot of it's how you sell it, you know, because like whenever I do ones where like we're on a trip or something, it's like, it's kind of fun, you know, like,
yeah,
it's actually, you can kind of make it fun, but it's like, you just kind of have to get like, okay, I'm vlogging right now, and you just do it. And it's kind of amazing. I don't know, like, I still haven't really done it in like in public. Like, I know like Kevin did one at Disneyland, and you guys did one at like the art museum.
Yeah.
And it's like, I still haven't gotten over that, but I'm imagining if I'm going to do it, you just have to just balls out, just do it, you know, like with like no fear, and just be like, all right, I'm owning it.
Yeah, that's still a problem with me. So, you know, there's always like things, oh man, I should have filmed that. That was cool. Or, you know, but I've got to, it's hard to get more comfortable with doing that, you know?
Okay, total side topic, because I just am interested and I want to know.
Yeah.
What's something you wish you had gotten that, like, you wish you had, like, vlogged and you didn't? Like, so, like, a huge, like, first thing on the top of your head for that.
First thing after this is probably the best thing, but that one where I was jogging and I came across that coyote, and at the time I had put my camera away, and because I came around the corner, and as soon as I did, like, he saw me and took off. But, and then I tried to get my camera ready and out and turn it on to film him, and he's halfway gone. So you barely see him kind of walking away. It's just, I don't know. Sometimes, you know, you're living life, you know, and just like, oh, that would have been a cool thing that somebody might be interested in. And then sometimes I'm filming things and like when I film my yard work, I mean, like, it's like, who really cares about this? But then I think, well, a lot of people, it's not super exciting, but a lot of people deal with this kind of stuff. Oh, I got to get my yard. I know a while back you were working on your backyard. So it's something people can relate to, and it doesn't always have to be super exciting. It just has to be something that somebody relates to, you know?
So here's mine. This happened like 4 days ago. So I did this stupid alphabet video, which if you guys haven't seen, you're on my channel, check it out after. But it's like this alphabet video where it's like making fun of, because my kid watches these ridiculous, like they're great for his age, like to learn the alphabet and stuff, and he's in love with the alphabet. So he like will watch these YouTube videos that are like A goes ah, B goes buh, and there's like kind of like generic toddler music in the background.
Mm-hmm.
And so I had done that alphabet poster for like to promote Quarterly Stories, and then I was like, one day just got in this weird mood. I was like, I don't really feel like vlogging, I just want to work on my comic, I'll just knock this thing out really quick. And then of course I ended up spending a ton of time on it, but it's like it's a fake alphabet video for toddlers, but it's like of my alphabet chart, which has like, you know, I is for indie, or D is for depressing.
Yeah.
So somehow my son saw me doing that, like editing it, and he wanted to watch it, and I let him watch it once, because it's like not, I think the most crazy, like adultish term is vulgar, like V is for vulgar.
Right.
But it's like all like weird, depressing, funny stuff, because I'm kind of poking fun of the fact that it's autobio and it's kind of dealing with really heavy subject matter. And like, so it's like E is for entropy. And I come home, like I'm driving home, and my wife calls, and my son like talks to me on the phone while I'm like, you know, driving, and he goes through it like he's memorized it.
Yours?
Yeah. So apparently while I was gone, like from that one time he saw it, he wanted to see it again and again and again. And I don't think he's aware that I did it. He just likes it because it's the alphabet, and it's perfect, you know? And so, like, he, like, will go all through it, all the way through, like, E is for entropy, but in a toddler voice. And when I got home, was like getting my camera because he did the whole thing. He was like, this is the quarterly stories alphabet. And he's doing the whole thing, like word for word. Even at the end, like I did like a corny, like, thank you, come again. And he did that. And I was like, dude, I have to have that on my vlog because that's like better than the thing I made. And the second I pressed record, he just stopped doing it.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, come on, Benji, A is for, and he's like, A goes, ah. And I'm like, no, like do the thing again. That was amazing. Like, so it was like one of those moments I'll have to, you know. And he did it again today. And like the second I tried to record it, it's just like,
yeah.
I will try to catch that and vlog at some point. It's unbelievable. Like I just thought it was hilarious. And I was like,
that's funny.
You have to do like a legit toddler video with like his name and stuff that like would be better for him to memorize than like D is for depressing. And it's like, I just keep imagining like at his preschool class or something, and they're just like, do you feel depressed a lot? It's like, no, it's just, you know, my dad made, like, you know, it's going to be a weird, like, Adam's Family style kid, but that's awesome. Anyhow, yeah, that's my, sorry, side note, but it was just really funny to me.
Yeah, that's the kind of thing that'll probably get more views if you ever do capture it than anything else you do.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I mean, like, but then again, who knows? Because it's my kids, so to me, it's like the world. But to the YouTube audience, I don't know. Maybe they don't. You know, maybe they. Like, that's the other thing I've learned about YouTube is like, there are things I'll be like super into. I'm like, this is hilarious. This is awesome. This is gonna kill. And it doesn't. And then there's times where I'm like talking in the car, and I'm like, nobody wants to hear me talk about this, but I want to talk about it. And then like, that'll be the thing that gets more views. You know,
yeah.
So, I don't know. I mean, at this point, I'm just kind of making ones that I think the people who are subscribed will like, and then sometimes I'm just making ones where I'm like, you know what? I don't know if anybody will like it, but I want to make it.
Yeah, you can. At least I can never predict what's going to get more views. It's always the thing that I don't think.
Oh man, see, now I want to jump topics. Can you jump topics?
I guess we're into it a ways. So I mean, we can either do another one, or we could, if it's something we just want to talk about briefly, sure.
Let's tease it out, and if it ends up going, because yeah, we probably have to call it. But so just a quick question, and then maybe we can get into it more in depth. But how do you feel about like pre-segments on YouTube, like? For instance, like I think somebody in the comments section recently mentioned me like the idea of like kind of pre-recording like bits for like, for instance, I have like my intro card, but like I say the same thing at the top every single time. It might make sense to just like pre-record it. My hesitance on it is that I still want to sound authentic. Like I want to be authentic when I'm doing it. So even repeating the pitch every time, to me, there's going to be little differences that hopefully keep people interested. Whereas I don't know if you pre-film that bit, like you have yours too for 100 days. Of course, yours is unique because you have the card and cross off the number of the day and stuff and talk a little more about the day and vary the pitch, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But I just like, I don't know. It's just something I've been thinking about. Like, how do you feel about just like what would happen if you pre-recorded it? Do you think people would just get bored?
So I've been thinking about this too, because after I wrap up my 100 days, like I'm going to keep the format the way it is through this because I've already established something. But I think when I come back, what I'm going to do is I'm going to get, and just based on things just to try to grow my channel and what people want. But basically what I'm going to do is before I run any kind of anything, you know, intros or anything like that, I'm going to basically get right to the subject. You know, we're going to talk about, you know, art support systems today. Do you know what that, you know, something like that, just right off the bat, then go to an intro, and I'll probably even make it quicker. Cause I think you have a limited amount of time to grasp people's attention, new people. Now, people that have been with you for a while, it's not so much a big deal.
Yeah.
But I think if you want to kind of grow your channel, you gotta get right to the point. So that's kind of what I'm going to be doing, is right to the point, run maybe a real quick graphic or something, and then go in, and then I'll do my little scaled down pitch about, you know, this is Scott with Cirqueworks Art Labs. Welcome to the underground lair where we create robots, aliens, zombies, and other immigrants, humanity, blah, blah, blah. And yes, then go back to whatever that topic is, whether it's a drawing video or art advice video or whatever. So that's kind of.
So that's the thing, like that. So that bit about the underground layer, like, do you think it would feel less authentic if you had like a pre-recorded bit that just kind of plugs in at the same time every time? Would that just be repetitive?
It's
more efficient. You can cut it down to a shorter amount of time.
Yeah, it might. It could, I mean, you could. It could be effective. It could. I guess it depends how you do it. I could see, like, if you do it kind of tongue in cheek, like if you had like some crazy announcer guy, like hire some voiceover guy to go, and now live from the underground lair, it's Scott with Cirqueworks or something. You know, I don't know. That might be stupid too, but just an example. You could do something like that, and then, you know, you could have a little pre-recorded thing. But I'm finding, and that's why I'm thinking about shortening some of my intros and things, just because. It's not, because originally if you were to go way back to like my first round of 100 days, and when I started talking about what I'm going to do for, you know, basically kind of like what I'm doing now, where I first started building the underground lair set and everything like that. And yeah, I had in mind that I was going to have this cool intro where you fly in, and I've still got the prop of the volcano and the layers inside the volcano, and you're coming from an overhead shot.
Like Playhouse kind of thing?
Like, yeah, well, that's kind of the idea. The only thing is, I don't know that YouTube is really, if that's the right format for YouTube. But now here's some other things I'm hearing, is that now that YouTube's doing this, what is the new thing they're doing? That whatever that paid version is, where they're trying to not YouTube Red, but it's almost like a Netflix type thing or something.
Like a television thing, yeah.
Yeah, they're going to try to do some more like television stuff. So some of the influencers that I listen to, like Roberto Blake, is talking about wanting to do something a little more like a show. Because if you can say, if somebody like a Jimmy Kimmel decides he's going to do some kind of YouTube content, and then if you're kind of in that same space, and if people are, if you can get linked from that, if you're doing something similar or something that's, you know, relevant to that, if you, they, you, you know, I don't know what, if that's realistic or not, but if you're, you know, maybe you can do some kind of a show on YouTube, but right now, I just don't know if people are, you know, if that's what they're looking for. So, you know, I'm constantly trying to tweak things around a little bit. And I still do want to do, it might be cool. I still would like to do some sort of a show. And At this point,
I have to see that Pee Wee's Playhouse intro. Like, I think that would be a huge seller. Are you kidding me?
That would be amazing. But it might have to be, like, the show in addition to everything else, and just make it something separate. So people, you know, that's the one thing that kind of does start off. But to do that with every video, because some people just want to learn stuff about art or what can help them in their art career and stuff like that. So I don't want to abandon those type of videos, but I still do want to do that. And if I get to the point where I can kind of do this full time, I'd love to be able to do like little puppets or something that interact in the lair and stuff. And that was the original idea. And just now with like Netflix just launched the Mystery Science Theater, because a lot of that was what inspired that, even down to like the green jacket. That's kind of like a Beekman thing, or like who was it? I forgot which. It wasn't TV's Frank, or was it? I don't know which. I forgot the names. But the one scientist had that kind of green jacket, stuff like that. So, But yeah, that kind of stuff. I mean, that's kind of what inspired me. So I kind of would like to do something like that. I just don't know if I'm really an entertainer so much. But, you know, I just kind of do what I do. I don't know.
Well, I don't know if you have to change the format. I'm just saying, like, I would get so excited. I mean, I like your YouTube channel already, and I'm already subscribed. But for me personally, just hearing you describe that, like fly, like a shot, like flying over the underground layer and flying into a volcano or something, if that was like how you introduced it every time, that would just sell the whole thing. Like, to me, like, the second you can do that, you should do it.
Yeah, like, it's props out my garage. I still want to. I will use it somehow. You know.
Yeah, that's incredible. That would be
the other thing it does is, because I don't know how many people actually get what I'm about, and I haven't encapsulated enough to make a pitch so people right off. I mean, I guess kind of the robots in the underground lair, I guess they can kind of get it.
Yeah,
but unless you watch enough, I don't think you understand that, you know, because right now mostly I'm doing comics, but to know that here I'm trying to create this sort of business where it's basically like the Acme company was to Wile E. Coyote. I am what, if you want to take over the world, that's where you would buy your supplies, and that involves the prints and all this other stuff. But
Yeah. Finding
a way to make that clear very quickly is hard, but maybe if I did some sort of intro. So, and just quickly in the chat, so Evan Moore says that was Dr. Forrester. Yes, okay, I don't remember. And then Mike says, definitely have to check this out, but he says, check out Captain Disillusion. He does a Beekman's World type show on YouTube. That I've got to check out. I will definitely check out that.
By the way, the new MS3K or whatever is like Jonah Ray, who's like hilarious. They're pretty good, I think, so far.
And then I watched the first episode yesterday. And
I wonder if we were watching at the same time.
We might have. We were like looking through, and I'm sitting there watching my girlfriend, and we're both cracking up, and I was like, I'm so glad you can watch this with me. I'm so glad you're as into this as I am.
I was super stoked that we shouldn't get too much on that, but
yeah.
I was stoked that they had the same feel and format.
Yeah.
They didn't like overdo, like the effects are still pretty corny.
Yep.
And you know, it keeps it really fun. So,
yeah, it's different enough, but it's also, and it's modern enough, I think.
Yeah.
I think they're a little more quippy, a little more, which I think you just need now with YouTube.
Oh, yeah.
They don't let it, they don't let it play as long as some of the other episodes. They got to be a little quicker, which I think
they're doing,
but it still, it feels the same. At least for the first video, I mean, I was digging it. And they added a few things, like now Tom Servo can kind of fly when he's inside the theater, and Gypsy kind of comes down, and she's like, now she's like mounted from the ceiling. And so, I mean, the improvements they made are cool, but it still feels the same. So,
yeah.
If you guys haven't checked that out, check it out. It's if you're a fan, because it's pretty awesome. And I didn't know how that was going to go, because, you know, so many people do that stuff on YouTube. I didn't know if it was still going to be relevant, but it's I love it. So.
Yeah, and like I will say, like Jonah Ray had a podcast on Nerdist for a while, and he's just like, he is really funny. He's just a funny guy. So it's kind of like it's really well chosen. Like. Okay, we gotta call it, I think.
Yeah.
We've gone a while. I think we nailed the topic. So so go out there and support each other. And, you know, I think you guys know where to find me. I think, Scott, maybe you should close it out too, because do you know the bit about the subscriber thing? I mean, you're handling it.
Yeah, I'm working on it. This time I finally got the link to work. I didn't realize the first... When I sent it out last week, I put the link in, but I didn't know you actually had to create a physical link, so people would actually have to like cut and paste it just to find it. But anyway, so there's a newsletter, and if you guys want to sign up, did you put the link in, Josh? Do you?
Yes.
Okay, so there should be a link in the description for the newsletter. If you guys haven't signed up, go ahead and sign that up, and what that'll do, we don't spam you or anything like that, but we'll notify you. Like in this case, you know, and I would have liked to send one out yesterday just to let people know, because we usually do it on Wednesdays, but today, you know, we had some issues and everything. Well, Josh was at the clam thing that we were talking about today. So we moved it, but if you, so you don't always know exactly when we're going to do it, usually Wednesday, but just in case, it would be good to have a way for us to notify you. And we'd like to try to send that out about 30 minutes before we go live. So you can join the newsletter, and like I said, we don't spam you or anything like that. And the other good thing is because this does, the show does rotate between Josh's channel, my channel, Kevin's channel. So just so you know where it's going to be, because if you're just paying attention, and it also makes sense to subscribe to all three of us. So I think I put everything in that little
notification. Scott, where can we find your work?
My work, you can find me at Cirqueworks.com. I'm at Cirqueworks on YouTube. I'm doing the 100 Days of Making Comics Challenge. I do robots, aliens, zombies, and other imminent threats to humanity. I sell mad science supplies. You can also go to madsciencesupplycompany.com, and I got prints and all kinds of cool stuff up there.
And you guys should keep the momentum going on as eBay. So, Etsy.
Yeah. So, yeah, if you search Cirqueworks on Etsy, you can find me. It's kind of the same. Either way, it doesn't matter. I mean, if you go to Etsy, kind of drives its own traffic. But my website has all the same stuff you can buy on Etsy. So, it's probably easier just to go there.
You get some prints. And keep that momentum going. And they're actually really rad posters. I'm still kind of waiting to be able to get some of my own. So, so that'll do it. Thanks, you guys. And I think that there was one thing. So I just finished my 99th blog, and the last thing I wanted to just mention is that for blog 100, I'm going to be doing a giveaway. I'm going to give away my first comic, a copy of that, and just ship it to you for free. And, you know, maybe if you want it signed or drawn on or whatever, I'll do that. So I'm going to do a giveaway for the 100th subscriber, for the 100th episode, for only subscribers who followed me for the first 100 episodes. So if you guys are subscribed to my channel, awesome. If you haven't, All right. I think that'll do it. Was there anything else, Scott?
Thanks to everyone in the chat.
Yes. Yes.
You guys are really hot. I mean, I couldn't keep track of most of the stuff. So, it looks like some good conversations going on in there. So,
yeah,
thank you guys.
I love it. I love it. All right, guys. We will see you guys next week. And now the awkward.